Praise the Lord, everybody. Say, praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. I tell you what, it's a beautiful day outside. Finally got some cold weather, thank God. I've been wondering where it's at. And now that it's here, I'm wondering if it'll ever leave. And we ain't never satisfied, are we? The wind blows, we have a bad hair day. If it rains, we get wet. But thank God anyway for the season. Praise the Lord. Won't you stand to your feet this morning? Let's bow our head and give God the glory. Father, we thank you for this service this morning. Thank you for those that have been able to come out. God bless those that's not here. Father, we just worship you and we honor you, Lord. We ask you to help us this evening and this morning. God, that you give us grace for the day and let us be a light into the city, God, that's lost and dying. Father, we praise you, we honor you, we glorify you. In Jesus' name. And the church say amen. We started out traveling for the Lord many years ago.
Thank you. Everybody's glad to be here this morning.
I've come too far to look back again. There's nothing behind me. All the treasures I used to know, they've all faded from you. There's a new day.
Turn around.
Look around, there's no
place your heartache in Jesus' hands. He can mend broken dreams. I've come too far to look back again. I've been walked through the valleys. See, I've climbed mountains, crossed rivers. There's a place inside your heart.
In Jesus' hands, He can mend your broken dreams. You know, the motto of this church is where the broken are restored. But I can see, as I look upon faces in this congregation this morning, there's still some brokenness in some of us. We've not given it completely to the Lord. To go in a little bit of a different direction. The Lord can't mend our brokenness unless we're willing to give it to Him. This morning, while I was in some prayer time, the Lord told me to go to 2 John 14th chapter. The very first verse says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." But that statement was important enough that in 27 verses later, he says again, "Let not your heart be troubled. Do not be afraid." That spoke to me. I just want to give an opportunity this morning for everyone here. That if you have some brokenness in your heart, that you would take some time. Let's make this time with God count this morning. He just wants you to crawl up in His lap this morning and give that brokenness to Him so that He can wrap His arms around you.
received a text message from Brother Rick Branson. They have rushed Susie's dad to the hospital unresponsive. And I want everybody to come in that knows the value of prayer. We're going to pray that the Lord just move on that.
A sound from heaven,
song, you might as well just shout it. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Lord is good. I said He's good. Veronica, can you feel Him up there in the balcony?
Amen.
All the kids are going to children's church. Be dismissed at this time. I'll tell you, I come in here this morning needing a refreshing from the Lord. Appreciate what He's done in my life, but I need Him this week. Hallelujah. I need Him this week. I told the church, and I don't want to tell something that I tell something that it not be the truth. I told the church I was going to be preaching this morning. A demonstrated message. Brother Terry is going to help me.
All right.
And so I want to follow what I said I was going to do. How many of y'all know that it's good to be in the house of God?
Hallelujah.
He's been better to me than I have been to Him. Let me just testify for a minute. I said He's been better to me than I have been to Him. He always comes through right on time.
Yes, He does.
The scripture that I'm going to read this morning, you can turn to in Proverbs chapter 20. Chapter 20 and chapter number 23. Chapter number 20 and chapter number 23. I may make some of you mad before you leave this morning. But there is a spirit going around that I hate with ever being in me. Preach against it this morning. Is that okay?
Yes.
Here, Brother Alvin. Keys are weighing me down. I want to get up this morning. I don't want to. Before I read the scripture that I'm going to read this morning falls from the lips of the wisest man in the Old Testament.
Amen.
Solomon's qualified to preach this sermon to Israel, to the nation of Israel, because of his experience in this place. Solomon's book of Ecclesiastes, the book that the Bible calls the book of the preacher, records 29 times Solomon stating the words under the sun. He tells us that he tried all the pleasures of this world and at the end counted them all vanity and vexation of spirit. 29 times Solomon said, I tried women under the sun.
All right.
Vanity.
Uh-huh.
29 times he said, I built vineyards.
Right.
Drank of the wine thereof, and he called it vanity.
That's right.
29 times he said, I gave my hands to the work thinking it would prosper me, but it's all vanity. He talked about grabbing a hold of this world. All vanity. How many of y'all know that there are things in this world that will give you a vexation of spirit?
Amen.
It will pollute the Spirit of God that's in you.
Amen.
Twist it up, mess it up to where you're just a vessel, empty.
Sure will.
I want to talk this morning from Proverbs chapter 20 and Proverbs chapter 23. I want to read one verse from Proverbs chapter 20 and three or four verses from Proverbs 23. Proverbs 20 verse 1 says, wine is a mocker.
Yeah.
Strong drink is raging.
Yeah.
And whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise.
Amen.
Everybody see that? Wine is a mocker.
Yeah.
Strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Flip now a page in your Bible to Proverbs chapter 23, verse number 29. The words of Solomon said this: who hath woe? Who hath sorrow? Who has contentions? Who has babbling? Who has wounds without cause? Who hath redness of eyes? They that tarry long at the wine. They that go down to seek mixed wine. Look not thou upon the wine when it is red, which means when it is fermented, when it goeth, giveth his color in the cup, when it moveth itself aright. At the last, he said, the last thing that thing can do is it bites like a serpent and stingeth like an adder. I want to preach this morning on the gospel against alcohol. Is that all right? The gospel against alcohol. I despise alcohol. Let me just say this to you. I want you to understand this morning and have no doubt where I stand when it comes to alcohol. When I get done preaching this morning, you'll all know what side I'm on. Is that all right? I'm proud to announce that I stand on the side of what the Bible says against alcohol. I stand on the side this morning of the mother that watches her children slide down that slippery slope of alcoholism. I stand on the side of a child that weeps over a dad that has given himself to strong drink and has forgotten his own children. I stand on the side of the family that stands over a coffin of a loved one that has been taken out by a drunk driver. If you look around this world, you'll be hard-pressed to find anything that has broken up more families and homes, filled more jail cells, hurt more children than alcohol. If you're mad at me right now, you're going to be real mad when I get done. Come on, somebody. It's not bad enough that we have to be concerned with the world's use of alcohol. We now have to worry about the people that declare that they know Christ and use it. We're living in a time frame right now that what most of the church calls themselves sipping saints. You're either sipping or you're a saint, and they both don't go together. Can I get an amen from anybody? Stand against this spirit of alcohol that has come. grapes. Hear what I'm about to tell you. First of all, he has a false peace. He tries to drown out his troubles. But friend, when the wine wears off, when the alcohol wears off, the trouble reappears. It's a false peace. You can go to the bar tonight. Your life can be in turmoil. It can be messed up. You can go to the bar tonight. Am I preaching right, Brother Ronnie? You can go to the bar tonight. It won't matter how many beers you drink. You might get a little peace for a while. You might forget your troubles and your woes and your trouble for a little while. But how many knows tomorrow morning when the sun comes up again, not only will you have a headache and a hangover. Yes, sir, the devil, amen, the enemy of your soul would have taught you that night into doing something greater while under the influence of alcohol. This is one man of God that's going to stand against that spirit. I'm not going to allow us to fall into this modern day thinking that we can drink a little bit and be okay.
Second of all, man has under the influence of false personality. When someone starts drinking, they become someone they are not. They'll do things they normally would not do. I've known of good men that were didn't have a temper, but you got a little alcohol in them, and they started being somebody they was not. I saw the black eyes. I saw the swelled up cheekbones of women that came to me and said, Pastor, he got under the influence of alcohol, and never before has he ever raised a hand to me, but he does. Oh, he come home staggering, keep the dog under the porch, whip the children too long. I forgot that he even had children. I understand the power of alcohol. Can I preach on and tell you? I'm telling you, you'll have a false personality. You become somebody you never were intended to be under the influence of alcohol.
Third, he has a false boldness. I know this because of when I used to drink. I was 145 pounds then. I weigh 172 now. I was 145 then, a size 28 waist. And I'd walk into a bar and get a 3 or 4 beers in me, and I was 10 foot tall and bulletproof. Come on, somebody. It wasn't nothing for me to think I was something greater. It's a false boldness. Walk over to a table. 3 or 4 grown men standing there. Reach down and get one of their beers. Drink that beer and slam it back in on the table. And dare those men to get up and do anything about it. Help they would. And I'd find out real quick that at 145 pounds, 5'10", I couldn't handle 4 or 5 men. No, sir. I had a false boldness. Can I tell you, somebody can get under strong drink. They become somebody they were not. They get a boldness about them. I'll tell you what we need to do. The church of the living God needs to get once again under the influence of the Holy Ghost and get a boldness again like we used to have. We ought not be ashamed that Jesus Christ is our Lord and the Holy Ghost lives on the inside of us. Do I have an amen this morning? You're preaching real good, Pastor. You're shouting even better. Can I tell you this morning, the church needs to get under an influence, but it doesn't come out of a wine bottle. It don't come out of a liquor bottle. It comes out of a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein.
Hallelujah.
Woo, I feel like preaching. I'm going to ask Brother Terry to help me. Oh, Brother Terry, bring the bottle down to me. Will you do that? Oh, now as y'all look at Brother Terry, in his hands you see a bottle. It's dark in color because, let me just share with you, there's no light in alcohol. No, sir. It's all darkness because it's from the pit of hell. You see a bottle in his hand. Oh, but it's more than just a bottle. It's a symbol of a broken home. It's a symbol of a dead child laying on the highway. It's a symbol of sleepless nights and guilty conscience. It's broken dreams.
preaching by experience. It's a child sitting on the porch with his suitcase packed, ready to go spend the weekend with his drunk daddy.
Come on.
That never shows up because the dad thinks more of the bottle than he thinks of his child. Yeah, I know all the power of it. When a mama would come outside and leave the light port, the porch light would be on, and she'd say, "Son, come in. Your daddy must not be going to come home or come tonight to get you." 11 o'clock at night, mama would shut the light out. I'd go into my room, and as a boy, I'd lay there in bed and think, "Alva, oh, dad must be up at the bar. Oh, I'm not preaching to make my dad look bad. I'm telling you what power of alcohol will do. I'm telling you, I'd lay there and think, somebody, daddy loves the bottle more than he loves me." Yes, sir, that's what takes place. So to inspire to be like my dad at the age of 14, I picked up the bottle for the first time. I started drinking behind my mama's back. Nobody in the family knew it. I had a liquor bottle stashed in the house and up in the woods. I know the power of it. 15 and 16. Oh, a little drinking. If dad knows I'm drinking, he'll love me. Dad, take me to the bar. I can sit on the bar. In his hand this morning is woe, confusion, and turmoil.
Yeah.
Brother Terry, bring me the bottle up, will you? Bring me the bottle. Thank you, sir. The bottle. The bottle. Oh, no harm in the bottle. Not to somebody that says they're saved.
Come on now.
Just a little wine.
Yeah, yeah.
Paul said a little wine for the stomach's sake. Well, honey, I'm not Paul and my stomach ain't aching. And Paul didn't drink wine like we drink fermented wine either.
Exactly.
In one hand, I've got the bottle.
All right.
You hear me? I'm going to hold the bottle in this hand. And I'm going to hold the Bible in this one. Do you hear me? In both of my hands is something that'll change your life forever. Yes, sir. In one hand, I have a bottle that'll change your life forever. You play with that bottle, sir. You drink of that wine. It may start off innocent. You drink it a sip now to calm the nerves. Maybe a social drink at supper time at night. Oh, but before long, you gotta have a drink in the morning.
Around just a little bit.
Come on.
somebody. No, sir, he never measured out the sin. He never said a little bit of it'll be okay. No, sir, Jesus' words to that woman was, go and sin no more. Don't ever do it again. And I tell you, he says the same thing when it comes to alcohol. He does not allow us to drink a little bit, no more than he allows the heroin act to push the needle part way up his arm and shoot a little bit of shot of heroin. Am I preaching anybody this morning? He doesn't allow us to smoke half of a joint, no sir, and be all right. I'm telling you, we that name the name of Christ are to depart from iniquity.
Some will go as far as say that they drink to be accepted by society. What's wrong with not being accepted? Who said that you got to fit in with this world? Let's look at some men in the Bible that gave themselves to drink, and I'll hurry with this and be closed. Genesis chapter 9. Verse 21. Thank you, sir. What do you say there after being used by God to build an ark to the saving of your own household? Hebrews says you were moved by faith and the whole world went to hell. Let me just share with you that Noah was the best preacher ever lived. Hear me. Up to Jesus. How do you know that preacher? His message saved eight people and damned the rest of them to hell. Do you hear me? He never preached a sermon that didn't reach the world. No, sir.
About the bottle. He said, let me tell my story.
My story was, I wanted to throw a party. I'd become the king of Babylon and I wanted to throw a party. So here's what I've done. Now this is the most important story right here. Listen to me. He said, here's what I've done. He said, we started drinking. We threw a feast that was unbelievable. He said, I mean, the table was spread. All my great men around there, the princes of Babylon is around me. We're having such a good time. The women are dancing before us. Oh, every spirit imaginable was inside there. He said, all of a sudden, I gave myself to wanting wine. He said, so instead of just going to get in the bottle, he said, what I've done was, he said, I sent some princes down to the house of God. Do you hear what I'm telling you? He said, I sent them down there to get the vessels that they used in worship to God. He said, I brought those golden vessels back to the kingdom of Babylon. He said, while we were having a party, I feel like preaching right now. He said, while we're having a party, I took the vessels of God and I put a little wine in those vessels and I drank of the wine from there. Oh, all of a sudden, when I got good and drunk, he said, I heard a voice from heaven speaking. He said, I saw sidewalk with him and say, let me tell you about Jesus. Go to church with me. That drunk would say, I'm going to hold to the bottle. I can't let go of it. It's got a hold of me. He said one day the preacher heard screaming coming from across the street. He said, by the time I got my shoes on to get over there, police department was there. I was trying to get dressed. It was at nighttime, trying to get dressed, get my shoes on. He said, the time I got there, the cops were there. That man given to the bottle had took a claw hammer and beat his two sons to death. And under the influence, the next day down at the jail, the preacher went to see the man. He walked up to the bars and said, what happened? He said, preacher, I don't know. He said, the last thing I knew is I started drinking. He said, that's the last thing I remember until the snakes came. He said, what are you talking about? He said, there was two snakes come out to the sidewalk helping me get in the house. He said, these snakes grabbed a hold of me and started twisting themselves around me. He said, I was killing snakes. He said, I picked up a claw hammer and started killing snakes, only to find out this morning that I did not kill two snakes. No, sir, I killed my sons.
Come on.
Yes,
God. The city of Chicago, Illinois, there was a man by the name of Mel. Mel had given himself to the bottle, become a drunkard, his wife, four kids. Mel would leave for 6 months at a time on drunk binges, come back, tear the house apart, looking for bottle, shaking. No food in the house.
Come on.
The mom scraping, trying to feed the four kids. And finally she looked at Mel and said, Mel, get out of this house and don't you ever come back. I'm done with you. My children are not going to see you die from alcoholism. Mel stumbled out the door. That mama was a good praying mama. Mel stumbled out the door down the road. And a year and a half went by. He never saw his children, never saw his wife, lived on the streets. One day, one of his neighbors ran into him on the street and said, Mel, sorry to hear about your daughter. He said, what about my daughter? I've not been home in a year and a half. The neighbor said, Mel, your little girl died of starvation because nobody was there to supply for the family. They're having a funeral today, Mel. They're having a wake for her back at your house. Mel goes down the street, goes to the house, comes up the back, through the backyard, knocks on the back door, and a family member opens the door and says, Mel, you get out of here. He said, oh, let me see my baby. I didn't even know she was dead. What she got? Starvation, Mel, it's all because you gave yourself to the bottle. That woman couldn't raise four children, couldn't feed them. It got so bad, you didn't care. He said, let me go in one time and just hug her in that coffin. The family member said, you go in and come right back out, Mel. So Mel goes into a room by himself where the coffin is, leans over that dead body of that three-year-old baby girl. While he's leaned over the top of her, he unbuttons his shirt and steals the shoes off of her body and sticks them in her shirt. Rises up and goes down to the local bar and goes into the bartender at New Wales. He said, Mel, I know you ain't got no money. He said, oh, but I need a drink. He said, look at me shaking. I need a drink. You ain't got no money, Mel. He said, no, I don't. He said, but I got these two little slippers. They're brand new. The neighbor bought them for my dead daughter, and I just stole them off of her feet from out of the coffin. He set the slippers up on the bar, and the bartender said, slippers aren't a good payment, but if that's all you got, I know you need the liquor. See, they don't care about you. He handed Mel that drink of liquor, one shot of liquor, and Mel drank it. Walked out of that bar. 4 months go by, Brother Tony. 4 months. He's drinking late on the streets. When one night he just happens to stumble into a mission.
Come on.
And they're singing the song, there is a fountain filled with blood. Drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. Mel fell in the floor on his face, repented, and God saved him. Here's
story. Mel raised from that occasion. And the only time he touched the bottle after that was 28 years in a row on the day of his daughter's birthday. He'd go back into an alley and get an empty bottle, go to her gravestone and tell her, "Your daddy still ain't drinking anymore. He's preaching the gospel." And he'd break the bottle on her headstone. Mel's last name was Trotter. Mel Trotter was one of the greatest evangelists that this world's ever known, from the city of Chicago. But it all happened when he made up in his mind to let go of the bottle.
Come on, brother.
Come on, Lori, to the pen. I'm going to tell you, if there's a doubt in your mind this morning that you can drink a little bit of wine and still be a Christian, I'm going to tell you, you're deceived.
Amen.
You can drink a little beer and be a Christian, you're deceived. You know what? I've emptied a many of these in years past. But when I got born again, I have never had anybody to buy me a bottle of Jack Daniels for Christmas.
Thank you, all right. Jesus.
You know why? Because they knew I'd switch fountains.
Amen.
And if they don't know, I don't want my daughter to say my dad sipped wine or whiskey or beer on Saturday and preached the gospel on Sunday.
Exactly.
I don't want there to be a gray area there.
No.
I'm standing in a hospital many years ago. Young man, bad car wreck, bad. Doctor standing around his bed, and I've been called to the hospital. I walked into the room. Drunk, he was drunk. 26 years old. I walked in and prayed over him and prayed for him. I left and come out into the waiting room where the boy's dad said to me, "Preacher, what's got into my boy? When's he ever going to quit drinking and acting crazy?" And I looked at that man and I said, "Probably the time his daddy does."
That's right, man.
He said, "I'm 50. My boy's 26. I don't want my boy like it." I said, "Do you want him to change enough to let go of that bottle yourself?" Now, there might not be anybody in here that sips the wine. Maybe I'm just preaching because I want to make a stand against it for this church. Or maybe somebody watching us by camera needs to hear the real gospel preached.
All right.
But I want to say this. What if your child picked the bottle up and never could lay it down again? You know how much woe is going to be on your life as a parent? If my daughter sees anything from me, I want her to see me standing doing what I'm doing right now. Nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else. You know the old saying, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. I'm going to stand.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'm going to stand. I've seen it. I see it every weekend.
Yeah.
The bottom. Is all staying.
Mm-hmm.
this morning. I'm going to stand right with Pastor. I believe it that way. It has to be that way. And I know when the Lord saved me, it didn't take me 12 weeks in AA to overcome. I didn't have to try 6 months to quit drinking. When I come up off that altar, amen, it was gone. The taste, the desire was gone. Now, as I've lived through this life, the enemy comes from time to time. And he tries to pull us back into the old things. But how many knows that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever?
Amen.
If he changed you then, you'd still be changed today. Praise the Lord. We're so thankful for the grace of God and all the power. But I thought about what he's talking about. You know, people try to use that Jesus turned the water into wine. How many knows that marriage at Cana was 3 days before the Passover? How many knows Levitical law said 7 days before the Passover could be no leaven in the house whatsoever? That wasn't a fermented wine. That was a symbolic wine of the Holy Ghost. Amen? And so, you know, next time somebody said, well, Jesus turned the water into wine, you can give that little tidbit of information there. Let them know real quick that that wasn't fermented wine. Amen? Praise God. Texas Valley Baptist Church burnt down a year ago. And they've asked Pastor Jody to try to help them raise some funds for their building and things. And so we've got these cookbooks here. And they've got quite a few recipes in them. And I think he said they were $20 a cookbook. And if anybody would like to help out, buy one of these cookbooks. Maybe it'd be a good Christmas present for someone. Thanksgiving's just a few days away. You might find something in here you want to try to make a little bit of. Just go back and see Jody. He'll get you a book. And this church, I know they will be very appreciative of it. I know if something like that was to happen here, we'd sure be appreciative of somebody to help us out. Amen? So if you can, just take and see Brother Jody after the service. And we want to let you know that every cent of this will go straight to that church. Amen? Praise the Lord. I'd like to get the ushers to come. That's what we'll dismiss this morning. Let the ushers come if they will. Get these offering baskets here for your tithe and your offering this morning. And we want you to know tonight will be at 6 o'clock. Looking forward to the service tonight. Looking forward to the Spirit of God tonight. You pray for me. I got me a new leg Friday. It's got a battery pack, a memory chip. Look here, I got an ankle I can move now. But the problem is my right leg wants to run, my left leg wants to walk. I charged that baby up, man, and I mean it. You ever see them cartoons where they're dancing and they're moving real slow up top, but their legs are really getting it? I put this leg on, that thing went to moving. I said, whoa, wait. So pray that I get the hang of this so I don't fall and hurt myself, amen. Praise the Lord. We want you to give this morning. Why don't you stand where you get deeper down your pocket? Amen. Praise God. Father, bless this offering. May it go for the kingdom of God, for the outreach to the lost. Father, we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, fellas. Once you give, shake hands, show yourself ready. Come back at 6 o'clock tonight.
Some
seed
for well down here. Some blood for
I'm
They're going to Mike's Air. That's the first Saturday in December, I think it is. You need to try to be here if you can. That's the youth meeting December the 3rd. They're going to Mike's Air. So remember that. And there's something else here. All right. Turning coats, gloves, and scarves for the homeless veterans today. And also turning all non-perishable food items into iron today for the Thanksgiving basket. So remember the gloves and thanks for the veterans. And turn in your non-perishable food items to Sister Ivy for Thanksgiving baskets. God bless you.